Today on Upfront, will the 2014 election be a fight to the finish? Next, the latest numbers. Could it be a close race for governor? It's our roundtable conversation today with two political insiders, State Republican Party Vice Chairman Brian Schimming and State Democratic Party Chairman Mike Tate. Then, a state lawmaker's personal story about drug abuse. His daughter is a heroin addict.
The scariest moments because I didn't know if she was going to live.
Today, the changes he hopes will fight the rise in heroin addiction and save lives.
Covering the issues important to Wisconsin. This is Upfront with Mike Boucher.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to Upfront. We're now just 1 year away from the 2014 election for governor, and there were signs last week that it could be a very competitive race. The latest Marquette University Law School poll shows Republican Governor Scott Walker with a slight lead over his one declared Democratic challenger, former Trek bicycle executive Mary Burke. Walker also has a narrow lead over another possible Democratic challenger, State Senator Kathleen Vineout, although both races are within the margin of error. So what are we to make of these numbers and the race to come? We're asking Mike Tate, chairman of the Democratic Party of Wisconsin, and Brian Schimming, vice chairman of the Republican Party of Wisconsin. It's good to have both of you on the program today.
Great to be here.
Brian, we'll begin with you. Any cause for concern there? You've got the governor in a horse race with two Democratic candidates. You've got job approval below 50%. Are you concerned?
Look, this race is going to be about whether the state goes forward or goes backward. And we've said that from the start, and we've said from the start that this race was going to be a hard-fought one. You look at everything
close.
The state's been through in the last, we don't know, but the truth of the matter is, you look at everything the state's been through in the last 4 years, you look at what Scott Walker inherited when the state's voters turned the Democrats out of the governor's office, the $3.6 billion budget deficit, the billions of dollars in tax increases, they've been raiding people's gas tax money, 155,000 working people lost their jobs in Wisconsin. You look at what he inherited, and frankly, the courage it took and the tough decisions it took, we feel very good about
that. But that's not where you want to be right now going into a campaign, is it?
Well,
with those numbers?
As I've said, we've always thought it was going to be hard fought and it was going to be close.
Democrats shouldn't be doing a touchdown dance, should they? I mean, couldn't you argue that 45, 46%, 44% is essentially the same group of people who say anybody but Scott Walker, that there's nothing more to it than that?
Well, I think what people are going to be focused on is the future, and they're going to take a look at the record that Scott Walker brought to the table. And obviously, I think we see a competitive race right out of the gate. Two other numbers that I think that were incredibly important in that poll was 72% of the people that responded, 72% of Wisconsinites, said that their own personal financial situation was worse or the same than it was from the time Scott Walker took office. And 65% of the people think that the future is going to be worse or the same than it is now. This is directly because of Scott Walker's policies that have left us in the dust when it comes to our Midwestern neighbors and job production and job creation. We've saw a $1 billion cut to education, and we've really seen somebody who, using his own words, has pursued a divide and conquer strategy rather than one that brings Wisconsinites together around the table to move us forward. And that's why I think we're going to see a change in the governor's office next year.
Speaking of divisions, are there divisions in your party? It seems like there's some people on the left part of your party who are just not excited about Mary Burke and may never be excited about Mary Burke. How big a deal is that for your party?
Well, look, I think that, you know, one of those things we did see in the poll is that Mary Burke is not very well known yet. And I think that the more voters get to know her, the more they're going to like.
Do you think the divisions are exaggerated?
I think the divisions are natural in a party that is known for not being the most disciplined on-message party from time to time. We're a big tent, you know, we're not monolithic like the Republicans. We got a lot of people in there. But I'll tell you, you know, I feel really good about the candidate that we have right now, and maybe we'll have more, maybe we won't. But I firmly believe that Mary Burke's going to beat Scott Walker in November 2014. Yeah.
Mike has to spend his time now reining in the more liberal ends of the party. The worst kept secret in state politics right now is those divisions in the Democratic Party.
Which your party is eager to try to.
Well, about Mary Burke. I'll help you out here. We know some things about Mary Burke so far. She voted twice on the Madison School Board to raise taxes to the top limit that she could on the school board. She's given $230,000, $23,000 a year in the last 10 years to liberal candidates and causes. across this country. And she left a Doyle administration, the Doyle-Burke administration, that at one time spiked unemployment in this state at 9.2%. Under Scott Walker, it's now down to 6.7%, not only well below, 2.5 points below that, but below the national average. So, look, Mary Burke will be plenty liberal enough.
Is your party going to continue to sort of take the side of the grassroots activists, as you now call them? I think they were union thugs back a little while ago. Now they're grassroots activists. You're like helping them in their arguments against his party.
We're trying to show all our cooperation we have in this bipartisan atmosphere we have here.
And be a first for your party.
Look, the plain fact of the matter is, Mary Burke, she's got some positions that are well to the left of this state, although she said she's making a no-promises campaign. We'll see what her promise is on Act 10, because she's refused to say what she's going to do on Act 10.
I think that, again, you know, what we have in Mary Burke is a different kind of candidate. She's someone who's, when she said she wasn't going to make any promises, what she was implying and what she has since said is, I'm not a normal politician. I'm not going to make promises I can't keep just to win an election like we've seen Scott Walker do. I'm someone that's not going to reject an idea just because it's a Republican idea or a Democratic idea. I'm someone that's going to pursue good ideas that put people back to work. And given Mary's track record, whether it's at Trek, turning it into an international company, or whether it's as Secretary of Commerce, when we had 84,000 more jobs than we do today, and we had an unemployment rate that was 2 percentage points lower than it is today. So if you want to talk about Mary Burke's record, it's one of job creation, it's one of someone who's a passion for education, and it's one of someone who can lead Wisconsin forward and end this division we've seen here.
Very briefly, are you going to have a Democratic primary? Is Kathleen Vinehout going to run?
Well, look, I think Kathleen Vinehout is a phenomenal public servant. I think she's an intellectual leader in the state Senate, and I think the most important thing for Wisconsin voters is that Kathleen Vinehout is still serving in public office in 2015, so she can continue to be the needed voice that we have.
Okay, I think I've got that. All right, okay. Let me ask about the state Senate, because that seems to be the battleground in 2014. Brian Schimming, give me your assessment. I mean, are a couple of your folks in trouble? Is Mike Ellis in trouble up in the Fox Valley?
I don't think so. I have a lot of experience.
Some of your conservative media thinks he's in trouble.
Well, we have an 18-15 majority in the state Senate now. Fox Valley is probably where I've done a lot of my work over the years. Mike Ellis is going to be reelected there, especially against a very, very liberal Democrat opponent. I actually think we may pick up a seat and be at 19-14 when it's done. I believe we're going to pick up the Racine seat of liberal Democrats Senator John Layman, and hold all of our current seats. It looks very good.
Including the Dale Schultz seat.
Absolutely.
I'll give you a chance to respond to that.
The Democratic Party is going to retake control of the state Senate next November.
You're going to make that prediction here.
Absolutely. I'm very confident of that. We're going to pick up the Dale Schultz seat, where you want to talk about divisions on the right. You've got a pretty big division there. You've got Howard Markline, supported by Scott Walker, who's out campaigning for Ken Cuccinelli in Virginia right now. We are going to beat Mike Ellis. Mike Ellis has been in office since 1970, and given Mike Ellis, his personality of bashing gavels and screaming and swearing, we actually hope he will do doors in his district to show off his sunny personality.
They say that every 4 years, I've noticed.
And we are going to pick up, well, he hasn't had a real opponent for a while. He's got one now. We're going to pick up an additional seat. We do think the Racine seat will be hard to keep, but we're going to win the state Senate majority back.
All right, guys, I wish we had some more time, but it's good to have you both here. Brian Schimming, Mike Tate.
Thank you.
Thanks for being on the program today. Later on up front, we'll take a look at another big Wisconsin race in 2014 for the 1st Congressional District, Paul Ryan's seat. But first, a family story leads to new legislation. Representative John Nygren on his daughter's heroin addiction and how he's fighting this growing drug of choice when Up Front continues.
Up Front with Mike Gouche, brought to you by American Transmission Company.